Romans 8:11. But the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead, if that spirit dwells in you, if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies, will also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. By his spirit that dwelleth in you. Here we, the saint talks about a spirit. A spirit person. The spirit of someone. The spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead. Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. There was a crown of thorn on his head. His beard was plucked, beaten with a rod and hands on his face. His body was scourged. It was like a plowed field. Hands and feet were nailed to the cross. And he died. A spear was pierced through his side, through the cavity, thoracic cavity, piercing his heart. Blood and water came. This mutilated, bruised body of Jesus Christ was buried in a sepulcher. One night, one day, two nights, 2 days, 3 nights, 3 days passed by. That body, bloody body, mutilated body, it is raised to life. That body comes out of the sepulchre. How is that possible? Here Paul says, it is the work of a spirit. It is the work of a spirit. The spirit of him. The spirit of him. That raised up the dead Jesus from the sepulchre. And if that spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, if that dwells in our body, it will also quicken our mortal bodies by his spirit. That spirit, even now it will quicken our mortal bodies. When we die also, when we are buried also, when our body decayed and decomposed also, that spirit will be able to quicken our mortal bodies. That is the spirit of God. If you read the Bible carefully, from Genesis to Revelation, Genesis 1:2, we see the Spirit of God hovering upon the face of the earth. And Revelation chapter 22 verse 17, it ends with the Spirit of God. So from the beginning to the end, we see the Spirit of God in the Bible. In the Old Testament, the Spirit of God came upon different people. God has chosen for different purposes. And as we are approaching the New Testament, the Spirit of God came upon Zacharias, the Spirit of God came upon Elizabeth. The Spirit of God anointed John the Baptist even when he was in the womb. The Spirit of God came upon Mary. In the life of Jesus, his conception was the work of the Spirit of God. When he was taking baptism, the Spirit of God came upon him. And his whole ministry was moved by the Spirit of God. God anointed him with the Spirit without measure. So he went about doing good, destroying the works of Satan, building up the kingdom of God by the anointing with which he was anointed. When he died and buried, it's the same Spirit that raised him from the dead. It is called the Spirit of God, it is called the Spirit of the Lord, it is called the Spirit, it is called His Spirit, it is called the Spirit of Jesus. And the New Testament, we call it a Holy Spirit. We call it a Holy Spirit. It's the same Spirit. Its function was different in different times. Samson had the Holy Spirit. Or the Spirit of God was upon him. It was to prove the mighty works of God through him. But in his personal life, probably he loved a girl, he induced his parents to arrange for that marriage, somehow it broke. Then he was going behind Delilah, etc., etc. But the Spirit of God was upon him. It was not a character formation for him. The Spirit of God was upon the prophets, upon the kings, upon the priests. They all were God's chosen vessel. In the New Testament, the Spirit of the Lord was upon Jesus Christ. He went about doing good. There was a prophecy concerning him. In Isaiah chapter 61, from verses 1 to 3, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, upon Jesus Christ. And in Christ we can also claim that prophecy. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings, gospel unto the meek, he hath sent me as an apostle to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint to them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty, beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, they that may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. The Spirit of the Lord was upon him. So Jesus was going about doing good. When Jesus started this ministry, he claimed this prophecy, Isaiah chapter 61, that's a prophecy concerning him. Because when he was starting his ministry in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, he took that passage, read it out, and he said, this day this prophecy is fulfilled. On this day the scripture is fulfilled. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. My dear brother, my dear sister, in the New Testament, it was a promise in the book of Joel. that all flesh shall receive His Spirit. Earlier it was to God's chosen people, to the judges, to the prophets, to the priests, to the kings. As the Old Testament is coming to a close, to the priest Zacharias, his wife Elizabeth, to Mary, to John the Baptist, with a divine purpose. But there was a prophecy in the book of Joel that all flesh, the Spirit of the Lord will come upon all flesh. It was fulfilled on the day of Pentecost. I don't want to get into the details. I don't want to make it a study. But on the day of Pentecost, the Spirit of the Lord filled all. Even before that, Jesus said, whosoever asketh shall receive it. We being the evil, we know to give good things to our children. How much more our Heavenly Father knoweth to give us Holy Spirit to them that ask. He that is thirsty, come unto me. Anybody. Anyone who is thirsty can receive the Holy Spirit. On the day of Pentecost, the disciples who were waiting for the promise to be fulfilled in the upper room, they received the Holy Spirit. That's recorded in Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 8, new converts through the ministry of Philip in the city of Samaria, when Peter and John went and prayed, they received the Holy Spirit. And in chapter 9, Saul, who was persecuting the church, when he was on his mission to persecute the church in Damascus, God met him. And when Ananias came and prayed for him, Saul received the Holy Spirit. That was at Damascus. And in chapter 10, a Gentile officer, Cornelius, it was in the land called Caesarea, far away from Jerusalem. When Peter went and talked to them, they all received the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came upon them. So it was in Jerusalem. It was in Samaria. It was on the way to Damascus. It was in Caesarea. And in Acts chapter 16 we read it was in Ephesus. It was in Minor Asia, today's Turkey. Paul ministered there. They became converts through the ministry of Apollo. Later when Paul went there, they all received the Holy Spirit. So it was not just on the day of Pentecost. Just in the 30 years of the apostolic history, at least in 5 places it is recorded people received the Holy Spirit and they were speaking in tongues. My dear brother, my dear sister, the Lord is filling saints through His Holy Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord is poured upon us. The Spirit of the Lord is poured upon us not just to do great miracles as Samson did, pulling out, uprooting a tree, tearing the mouth of a lion. It's not for that purpose. The Holy Spirit is poured upon us. The Holy Spirit came upon Samson, he just tore a lion into 2 pieces. So you receive the Holy Spirit not to go around and tear dogs. Don't do it. The Holy Spirit is poured upon us that the fullness of the Spirit could be revealed through us. It's not tearing a lion or a dog. It's not just uprooting a tree. It's not just pulling down the lintels of a city gate, not to fight battles. The Holy Spirit is poured upon us for His divine nature to be formed in us. There is a Bible passage that shows the fullness of the Holy Spirit. So why should the Holy Spirit come upon us? Why should the Holy Spirit came upon Jesus Christ? I'd love to show you a Bible passage that gives us the characteristics, the full characteristics of the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. You call it a Holy Spirit, Spirit of God, Spirit of the Lord, whatever it may be. The fullness of the characteristics of that Spirit is given in Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. If you got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. And there shall come forth a root out of the stem of Jesse. It's a prophecy concerning Jesus. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. In Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord has come upon me. Here, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, rest upon Jesus. And it is described, it is a spirit of wisdom and understanding. It is a spirit of wisdom and understanding. The spirit of counsel and might. The spirit of knowledge and of the fear of God. A sevenfold description of that Spirit. A sevenfold description of that Spirit is given. It is the Spirit of wisdom and understanding. It is the Spirit of counsel and might. It is the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of God. It is the Spirit of the Lord. This Hanukkah, or the candlelight. It is a candlelight that was in the tabernacle of God. This candlelight speaks about the characteristics of God. The candlelight speaks about the characteristics of God. It is the spirit of wisdom and of understanding. It is the spirit of wisdom and understanding. It is the spirit of counsel and might. It is the spirit of counsel and might. It is the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. It is the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. It is the spirit of the Lord. It is the Spirit of the Lord. So the Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of knowledge, Spirit of fear of the Lord, Spirit of counsel, Spirit of might, Spirit of wisdom, Spirit of understanding. These are the seven characteristics of the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. So when we receive the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes into our mortal body, we receive the Spirit of wisdom, Spirit of understanding, Spirit of counsel, Spirit of might, Spirit of knowledge, Spirit of fear, Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of the Lord. So Holy Spirit doesn't come into us without Spirit of wisdom. Holy Spirit doesn't come into us without Spirit of understanding. It is one Spirit. The seven candles of one Spirit, His Spirit. His Spirit got the seven characteristics. So when you receive the Holy Spirit, you can't say wisdom is not burning. You can't say understanding is not burning. You can't say the Lord is not burning. You must have all those seven things together. That is how the Spirit of God is coming into us. That is how the Spirit of God is coming into us. So if you have got the Holy Spirit in you, You must have all these seven characteristics in you. What is the spirit of wisdom? About the wisdom, any time I have talked to you, what wisdom is? Wisdom is the best means to reach best, best means to get best results. Wisdom is the best means to get the best results. That's a very simple definition. What really is wisdom? Wisdom, you have got a noble goal, aim, a result. You have got a noble goal. You want to reach. You aspire to attain that goal. So what is that you are doing? You choose the right way. You are not attaining the goal in a wrong way. Somebody wants money. He wants to earn money. There's nothing wrong in it. Earning money is not wrong in it. So he chooses the right way to earn money. Somebody chooses the wrong way to earn money and he gets caught. He's not blessed, he's cursed. He's cursed. So a desire to earn money is not wrong. But what is the way you have chosen to earn that money? Number two, not only right way, you must have less effort to earn money. You put lot of effort and earn a little. That's foolishness. That is foolishness. To get that money, what is that effort required? You should have only that effort. So you can't waste your resources, your energy. So right way, less effort, simple method. You can't have a complicated method. You want to eat, there's a simple way you can eat. You can't twist dons and eat. You can't twist dons and eat. So achieving what we aspire in the right way, with less effort, in a simple method, it is called wisdom. It's called wisdom. To put it in a simple way, best means to get best results. Okay, what is that goal? Is just to earn money, name, fame? Something more than that. As Christians, we got a beautiful aim. Somehow I should reach heaven. Somehow I should reach heaven. One of my friends, who was also a ministry partner, whenever he used to give this type of a story, when he starts his testimony in meetings. After finishing his college, a young boy went to his grandfather. Grandfather asked him, what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to find a job. Okay, after that what? After that, I must build a house for me. Okay, after that what? After that, I should get married. Okay, after that what? What's your ambition after that? After that, children? Okay, after that, I should say children get married. Okay, after that, my retirement plans. Okay, after that, I'll die. After that, what's your aim? What's your aim? I must go to heaven. That's your long-term plan. You are getting married, you are having children, you are having grandchildren, you are getting your own house, everything. They are means to achieve that goal. They are only means to achieve that goal. What is the goal? I should reach heaven. I get married, I do ministry, I become a pastor, evangelist, everything. That's not the goal. I become a pastor, that's only a means for me to go to heaven. That's in the passage. Evangelist, that's a passage. I'm an evangelist, I don't go to heaven, what is the use of this? I am a pastor. I may be a blessing to 100 people, 1,000 people. If I lose my own soul, what benefits that me? So all these things, they are only means. They are not the end. The end is, I must reach heaven. That's my goal. So what's the right way to reach goal? What's the required minimum effort for that? I must be wise. I run here, I run there, I go around the world without sleep, without food, I preach the gospel, and finally I don't go to the kingdom of God. Only thing, I earned money through my ministry and I don't go to the kingdom of God. What profited that me? So I must have put effort enough to reach heaven. It's not to earn more money through ministry. I must have wisdom. I must have wisdom. And number three, am I doing it in the right way? I may perform miracles. I may raise the dead. I may prophesy. On that day, if he could tell me, you worker of iniquity, I don't know you. What's that? What profit that to me? Am I using the right methods? What is that method? Right way, minimum required effort, and simple method, just doing the will of God. Just doing the will of God. Then I become a wise person. The wisdom of God. Not only just going to heaven, in everything what I get is the wisdom of God. See, after all, we want to be happy. I have told this story many a time. Bear with me if I have to repeat it again. If you know it very well, if you don't know it now. Alexander the Great was returning from his battle, conquering almost the whole known world at that time. So when he was coming back to Greece, on the outskirts of the city Macedonia, his guru's guru was there. So he thought that he could pay homage to his that guru and go to his city. So he went there. The guru was sitting on a stone and he was throwing some breadcrumbs to a dog there very happily. The dog also wagging its tail happily, eating the breadcrumbs he was throwing. Alexander came with all his convoy. So this guru was not paying no attention to it. He was spending time with the dog. So Alexander said, Alexander the Great is come. He didn't bother. Second time also guru didn't bother. It was a little embarrassing to Alexander. Third time Alexander said, I am Alexander the Great. With the joy of conquering the whole world, or bringing the whole world under the umbrella of Greek, I am come. Bringing the whole world under the umbrella of Greek, with that joy, I am come. With that pride, I am come. Even then this guru didn't look at Alexander, but he told the dog, we didn't do that much. We didn't do that much for this. We didn't do that much for this. இதுக்காக நம்ம அவ்வளோ கஷ்டப்படல. எதுக்காக? To get this joy, this fulfillment, this happiness, Alexander has to wage war against many people, many countries. Many soldiers were killed. If there were deaths in the opponent camp, there will be death in our camp also. Many Grecian soldiers were killed. Many women were made widows. Many children were made orphans, fatherless. With all this bloodshed, by taking many people as captives, now Alexander has got joy, a fulfillment, an achievement. What's that after all he got? After all, what's that he got? Joy, fulfillment. Now this wise man says, for that, we didn't do this much. This wise man was able to get that joy by throwing these crumbs of bread to the dog. He gets that joy. He was not killing anybody, he was not shedding any blood, he was not making any woman widow, he was not making any child orphan, he was just feeding a dog, he is getting that joy. He is wise man. Alexander was not a wise man. All through the history, for these 2300 years, nobody calls Alexander a wise man. They may call him great, they may call him a warrior, but nobody would call him wise. He was not a wise man. To get that joy, to get that fulfillment, he didn't choose the right way. He didn't have the least minimum required effort to get happiness. The method was not simple, it is more very cruel. He got his joy, he got his happiness after all. But a wise man was not spending that much to get that joy. He is able to get that joy without doing all those things. My dear brother, my dear sister, are you wise enough to get your heavenly peace? Many people they don't have peace, they don't have joy. They think they got Holy Spirit. If I got Holy Spirit, you'll be wise enough to have peace, you'll be wise enough to have joy. Many people are got a lot of problems in their life. They talk about problem. Always in a joke letter, I say one sister, she went home with a long face, she was very upset, she was very sad. Husband asked, what happened? No, that particular sister, yes. Today she didn't even talk to me, so what? She didn't even say praise the Lord to me. I don't know why, what happened? She just turned her face and went. For that, this sister is very sad, all through the week. Next Sunday when she went back home, she was worse. Husband asked her, what happened? No, really, I don't know what happened. I said, what's the problem? I don't know, the sister came, talked to me again and again with all smiling face, showing her 32 teeth. I don't know why she was talking to me. Last week the problem, why didn't she talk to me? This week the problem, why she talked to me? For some people, they love to have problems. They can't be without problems. They don't know how to be happy. But for them to say they got the Spirit of God, it's a question. They may speak in tongues, but truly do they have Spirit of God? If they have Spirit of God, they will have wisdom. Wisdom is to achieve your goal. Happiness is your goal. Peace is your goal. Harmony is your goal. You must have wisdom to achieve that. You must have wisdom to achieve that. If you don't have wisdom to achieve a goal, one component of the Holy Spirit is missing. Okay, to save time, let me go a little fast. Otherwise, this message will go for another 7 weeks. So it is the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of understanding. Understanding is a beautiful English word that stands under. That's the base. That's the base. Understanding. There's the source that stands under. Another word for that is substance. Substance. Stands under. Substance. To make idli, idli flour is the substance. Idli flour mixed in the proper proportion is the substance. not the rice flour, not the dal flour, mixed in the proper proportion, allowed to permeate for particular timings, then that becomes a substance, not rice, not dal, not rice flour, not dal flour. The proportion, the time, and only some hands will have that rasi also. With some hands, it won't permeate. Some people are very proud. அது என் கையில் பிசைஞ்சாதாங்க அது புளிக்கும், சில கைக்கெல்லாம் புளிக்காது. அப்படின்னா அவங்க கையில் நிறையா பாக்டீரியா இருக்குதுன்னு அர்த்தம், வேறு ஒன்றும் இல்லை. அவங்க கையில் புளிக்காதுன்னா அவங்க கையில் பாக்டீரியா இல்லைன்னு அர்த்தம், அதுக்கு என்ன பண்ணுறது? சரி, இதுக்கு ஒரு பெருமை. So with all that, only the permutation can take place. Permeating it can be possible. Then it becomes a substance, understanding. The philosophic meaning of the word understanding is acting positively on the knowledge we have received. Acting positively on the knowledge we have received. Wife has got headache. You got the knowledge, now act positively on the knowledge you have received. Husband is very tired, he has slogged all through the day, you got the knowledge, act positively on the knowledge you have received. Then you got understanding. In many houses the problem, one will not understand the other. It was a spirit of confusion as it was in Babel. The wife will never understand what the husband says, and the husband will never understand what the wife says. She will be cursing her with the words, "You na enna sonnalum avarku puriyave matta, he doesn't understand whatever I say." He will go to the office with a swollen face and he will tell his friend, "My wife is such a good woman, but only one problem. What is the problem? She understands, she doesn't understand what I mean." நான் சொல்கிறது என்னன்னே அவள் புரிஞ்சிக்க மாட்டேக்கான். த சைல்டு வில் கோ டு ஸ்கூல், டெல் ஹிஸ் ஃப்ரெண்ட், மை பேரண்ட்ஸ் டோன்ட் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் மீ. இந்த ஈவினிங் பேரண்ட்ஸ் கம் டுகெதர், ஒன்லி ஒன் திங் தே டாக் லவ்விங்லி, ஆல் தி அதர் டைம் தே குவாரல். ஒன்லி ஒன் திங் தே டாக் லவ்விங்லி, வாட் இஸ் தட்? நம்ம பிள்ளைங்களுக்கு நம்ம புரியவே மாட்டேங்குது. இன் ஒன் திங் தே கன்கர் ஆல் டுகெதர் இன் தட் ஃபேமிலி, தே ஆல் டாக் த சேம் லாங்குவேஜ், இங்கிலீஷ் ஆர் ஹிந்தி ஆர் தமிழ் ஆர் மலையாளம், தே ஆல் ஸ்பீக் த சேம் லாங்குவேஜ், பட் நோ ஒன் கேன் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் தி அதர். அண்ட் த வேர்ஸ்ட் திங் இன் சம் சர்ச்சஸ், த காங்கிரிகேஷன் டோன்ட் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் த பாஸ்டர், பாஸ்டர் டசன்ட் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் த காங்கிரிகேஷன். எவ்வளோதான் பிரசங்கம் பண்ணாலும் அவங்க புரிஞ்சிக்கவே மாட்டேங்கிறாங்க. நம்ம பிரச்சனையை பாஸ்டர் புரிஞ்சிக்கவே மாட்டேங்கிறார். இட்ஸ் அ ஸ்பிரிட் ஆஃப் கன்ஃபியூஷன். பட் வென் வி ரிசீவ் த ஹோலி ஸ்பிரிட், இஃப் இட் இஸ் த ஹோலி ஸ்பிரிட், த செகண்ட் காம்பனன்ட் இஸ் த ஸ்பிரிட் ஆஃப் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங். இட் இஸ் நாட் ஓன்லி அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் ஒன் அனதர், அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் த ட்ரூத். What do you mean by understanding the truth? When I understand the truth, I act positively based on the truth. When the Bible says, don't adorn yourself with all this worldliness, when I understand, I act positively on that. Yes, I know it is in the Bible, but you are unable to act positively on the knowledge you have got. So you don't have understanding. You don't have understanding. We all know that one day we will die. We all know that one day we will die. If we act positively on the knowledge we have got, we have got understanding. We all know that we will die, but we act positively on the knowledge we have received. So that is why God says, my people have no understanding. My people have no understanding, this light is not burning, this candle is not burning. No wisdom, no understanding. Okay, what is the third one? It is the spirit of counsel, right advice in many critical situations. When I have to turn to the left or to the right, I need counsel. Counsel alone allows me to take right decision. If I take a wrong decision, it will be disastrous, it will be suicidal. I have to cross the road. My right decision will help me to reach the other side. My wrong decision will prove fatal. Do I take a right decision? In my marriage, do I take a right decision? In my career choosing, do I take a right decision? Do I have counsel? From where do I get counsel? For ministry, I must choose the right ministry. When God wants me to be a missionary, I cannot be a pastor. When God wants me to be a pastor, I cannot be a missionary. I need a counsel. I want to do the ministry. When I want to preach a sermon, I have to take a right decision. I want to preach, I want to continue the series, approve I. But I have to do what the Lord wants me to do. It's not that what I want to do. I need counsel. So in your career choosing, in your marriage, in your ministry, in every area of your life, in a very simple biblical word, when you have to turn to the left or to the right, you must hear the voice, "This is the way, walk herein." The Spirit of God is the Spirit of counsel. He is a mighty counselor. His name shall be called Counselor. Do you get counsel from Him? Don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. In Tamil we see Dunmarkar. He's not a Dunmarkar, he's ungodly. He doesn't have the fear of God. He didn't yield to the truth as you have done. He gives you counsel, write a letter like this. You dress like this. You talk like this. You stand like this. He gives a counsel. My dear brother, my dear sister, counsel of the godly, counsel of the servant of God, counsel of the Word of God, above all, counsel of the Holy Spirit. If you don't get the right counsel, that means advice, direction, decision making. If you are not led by the Holy Spirit, it will become disastrous. Is this light burning? Spirit of wisdom? Spirit of understanding? Spirit of counsel? And spirit of might? The spirit of might is not to tear a lion. Spirit of might. To be strengthened, the inner man, with all the strength of the Holy Spirit. We read that in Ephesians chapter 3 verse 16. Be strengthened with all his strength in the inner man. Let come what may. Even 1,000 will fall to my left and 10,000 to my right, it shall not touch me. We saw the strength of that pastor in Sri Lanka. His own child died in that massacre. He has got the strength to forgive the perpetrators. Strength in the inner man to say, "Father, they know not what they are doing. Forgive them." To say through that media to the brain behind this gruesome act, "We love you. We love you." Have you got the strength in the inner man? When your husband says a word, when your wife says a word, to say "I love you," to say "I forgive you." If they say one word, you say two words. If they say two words, four words, a geometric progression. Cursing, swearing. Do you have that might Is that light burning? Do you have that might, that strength in the inner man? Any persecution. I don't say we should be arrogant. He never opposed. He never withdrew. He never opposed. He never withdrew. Are you the king? Yes, I am the king. My dear brother, my dear sister, we need that strength. It's not only just to perform miracles, we need the strength to perform miracles. But the Holy Spirit is not the strength to perform miracles. Sickness is healed, maybe through medicine. Allopathy, homeopathy, so many pathies. It may be healed. Even if you don't treat it, sometimes it may heal automatically. At times the malady, remedy becomes worse than the malady. You take more tablets and you spoil your kidney. Otherwise, naturally it may be healed also. In those days, going for medicine and all is very rare. In what I'm saying, 68, one of our classmates, he joined medicine. So in a very jocular way, he used to say, so I said, what's that you study in medicine? He used to say, if you don't take medicine, your cold will take 3 days to be healed. If you don't take medicine, your cold will take 3 days to be healed. If you take medicine, in 3 days it will be healed. That's the only difference between medicine. If you don't take medicine, it will take 3 days. If you take medicine, in 3 days it will be healed. So healing may take place through medicine. They go to different places, this coil, that coil, this darga, this guru, that guru, somewhere and all they go. They say some nature, they say they are healed, miracle has taken place. Medicine performs miracle, nature performs miracle, these type of places also they say miracle, they talk miracle. And miracles take place through prayer also. Sometimes it's a very sad thing. It's not a sad, it's a very strange thing. You just listen to the news, TV channels. One channel they say, I took this medicine, that medicine, I am healed. Another channel they say, I went to this Guruji, he did this, he did that mantra, I am saved. Another channel it says, I went to a numerologist, he wanted to change my name. He wanted to add one A to it, one P to it. I did it, I am healed. Another channel, I went to so-and-so, he prayed for me, I changed. Here the rate is also higher. Immediately I spent so much as an offering, 1 lakh as an offering to their ministry, to their TV program. So I'm not saying miracle should not take place, miracle may take place. But the might of the Holy Spirit is not just healing headache. The might of the Holy Spirit is not prophesying. The might of the Holy Spirit is not stopping a rain. Even a wind will stop a rain. The might of the Holy Spirit is the strength in your inner man. It is the strength in your inner man. To save time, let me go a little fast. Number 5, what is the Holy Spirit? It is the knowledge. Knowledge is not the knowledge who is the president of America, it's the knowledge, it's not the knowledge who is the president of India. Many of us may know who is the president of America, I don't know how many of us can tell correctly who is the president of India, it's a very sad thing. There's knowledge about eternity. It is the knowledge who created heaven and the earth. It is the knowledge how man came. Because some people think man came from monkey, man came from monkey. They got every right to doubt. Because they may have the doubt whenever they would see the mirror. We can't help it. We'll just give room for them to have their own doubt, but we must know how we came. The sad thing, we also many a time think that we came from monkey. At times some people think they came from not monkey, then donkey. So we must have the knowledge. What is the relationship between God and Jesus? Why do we say Jesus is God? Is Jesus God? Or who Jesus is? A knowledge. The knowledge of God's fullness. Knowledge of eternity. What will happen after death? The knowledge. A supernatural revelation. Knowing it supernaturally. Knowing the Word of God. Knowing it rightly. That knowledge we must have. To save time, let me go first. So, is the light burning wisdom? Light burning understanding? Counsel? Might? Oh, might is here. Might? Knowledge? Then fear of God. Reverence for God. Reverence for God's presence. Reverence for the Word of God. I fear God. If you fear God, you will obey God. If you say you fear God, you will tremble at the Word of God. Word of the fear of God. And finally, the Spirit of the Lord. There are three spirits that can come into our body. I don't want to get into the teaching. One is the spirit of the devil. The spirit of the devil can occupy our body. The spirit of the devil. Next one, the spirit of the world. So we want to dress like the people of the world. We want to have our hairstyle as the people of the world. We want to behave like the people of the world. Pastors want to have posters like the people of the world. The worldliness. The worldliness. There's the spirit of the world. Spirit of the devil. We lie. We speak evil about others. We love to do the works of our father, the devil, in an eagerly way. நம்முடைய பிதாவாகிய பிசாசினுடைய கிரியைகளை ஆவலாய் நடப்பிப்போம் when the spirit of the devil comes into us. That's why we lie, that's why we speak evil about others, that's why we do something that could spoil the lives of the other people, that could disturb the ministry. It is because of the spirit of the devil in us. The third thing, the spirit of the Lord. The spirit of the Lord. The nature of the Lord. The Spirit of God came upon Samson, but not with all its fullness. He did have the nature of Jesus. Elijah has got the Spirit of God. Elisha had the Spirit of God, but not the nature of God. Not the nature of God. But we have got the Spirit of the Lord. The nature of the Lord. That's why when James and John said, when they were not allowing Jesus to pass through Samaria, we'll bring fire from heaven and burn these people. Jesus said, what spirit do you have? What spirit do you have? And that's why Paul says, if one doesn't have the spirit of Christ, he doesn't belong to Christ. He's not a Christian. The nature of Christ. It is not the nature of Moses, it is not the nature of Abraham, it's not the nature of David. I get the nature of Christ. If I got the counsel of wisdom of God, understanding, counsel, might, fear of the Lord, knowledge, nature of the Lord, I got the Spirit of the Lord in me. This is the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. And if that Spirit dwells in me, it's not just something you make noise like a quack, 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 quack. Because you make noise, you don't think. That spirit will raise you up from the dead. No, you must have wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, fear of God, nature of God. If that spirit dwells in your body, you can be confident that that spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead will also raise up as will also quicken our mortal bodies. It's not that we are happy that we feel the Holy Spirit, it's better that we understand the nature of the Spirit. May the Lord help us experience, enjoy the fullness of the Holy Spirit in our life. With good wisdom, with good understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, fear, and the nature of the Lord. Shall we just close our eyes? Look unto the Lord. The spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. This is that spirit. It is the spirit of wisdom. It is the spirit of knowledge. It is the spirit of counsel. It is the spirit of understanding. It is the spirit of fear of God. It is the spirit of the Lord Himself. Lord, let that spirit fill me, O Lord. Let my life be a life filled with the Holy Spirit, means filled with knowledge, filled with understanding. Let that Spirit come upon my body. Dear Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, O Lord. Thank you for this good understanding you're giving us about the Spirit we have received, O Lord. Bless your people, O Lord. Bless your people, O Lord. I pray for the young and the old, boys, girls, brothers, sisters. Lord, I pray for them. I pray for myself. Lord, I know that I have received the Holy Spirit's fullness. Help me experience and enjoy the characteristics of this Holy Spirit which is in me, O Lord. It's not just to tear the mouth of the lion, or to uproot a tree, or to pull the lintels of a city gate, O Lord. But to have good understanding, to have wisdom, knowledge, the fear of the Lord, the might in the inner man, O Lord, that fullness help me experience in my life. We thank you, we praise you, we worship. Bless your congregation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.